reminders that I get of different concerts, but please make sure you attend at least one concert outside our school program in the public that's out there, okay? So I leave the stage to Ram Prasad.
Yeah. Namaste Jayanti and namaste everybody. My name is Ram Prasad, and just now Jayanti was telling about the importance of attending concerts. And today's topic actually is very much aligned with that. When you go to a concert, you want to appreciate what is happening there. Sometimes we do understand, as students of music, as we attend more and more concerts, we gather more information, we can understand it better and better. Music is a demonstrative art, meaning whatever amount of talking about music is not going to tell you how it sounds, right? You can talk about at length for 1 hour about Raga Mohana. You can say it has 5 suras, it has Sariga Pada, Sa Sada Pada, Risa. You can say what and whatever you want to tell, but that is not going to tell you how it sounds. But instead, just like the kids sang right now, right? They sang the varna. Singing that varna in front of you will give you a much better picture of the raga than talking about it. But sometimes what happens is, understanding the theory behind something helps you appreciate what you are witnessing in a concert. So, it is in that respect I took this topic of Graha Bheda. This is a fairly sophisticated technique. I mean, everybody may not be doing it, but if you attend a concert, more likely is that you would have an example of Graha Bheda done performed in the duration of the concert. So, to understand what is happening there, if you know the mathematical background, the scientific background behind that will greatly help you. So that's why I have chosen this topic, and as I go along, I will play certain clips to illustrate what is happening and how you can understand what is happening. Okay?
Oh.
Chair, parvaila, it's fine. Now, what I will do is, as I go along, I will play certain clips.
Yeah?
I'll sing small segments, and I'll also show you, I'll play you certain clips, and you can try to identify what is happening there. If you understand, good. If you don't understand, that's fine, and that's the idea of this presentation. First, what I'll do is I'll play a short clip. Just listen keenly and observe what is happening. If you find what raga is being sung, it's very good. Otherwise, I'll definitely tell you what is happening. So just listen to this short clip.
Oh.
Okay, did any of the students get what raga was being sung?
Guess.
You can make a good guess. Okay, try.
Kalyani.
Okay, so it was actually Kalyani being sung. Okay, you remember one of you actually sang Sani Dapam for Ramappa, right? So that was in Raga Kalyani. But as the raga progressed, the vocalist, Balmurali Krishna, what he did is, he sort of started singing into Todi. That is another raga. But, and if any of you know the Todi Varna, the Todi Sojati, you might know that raga. Otherwise, don't worry. It's another raga, okay? So, in between, when he was singing Kalyani, he went off into Todi and came back to Kalyani. You might know certain compositions called Ragamalike, where there are multiple stanzas and each stanza is sung in a different raga. But this is not like that. Here what he did was, using the swaras in Kalyani, he gave the feel of the raga, another raga, in this case Todi. And this is done with what we call Graha Bheda. Okay, I wanted to play this one even before we tell anything about what Graha Bheda is, to show you how it feels. Now, so to understand this, it's good if we know certain technical terms. Okay, many of you might know this. If you don't know, if you know, it's just a revision. See, otherwise, we'll just go through that. All ragas have different characteristics. They all have different swaras, right? You different notes. Some of them have 5 notes, some of them have 6, some of them 7, some of them straightforward, some of them are crooked or vakra. And similarly, all ragas also have certain characters like graha, amsha and nyasa. To be simply saying, make it very simple, graha is the note with which you start a raga. And amsha is the note that's very prominent in a given raga. And some ragas might have more than one amsha, meaning more than one jiva swara. And nyasa is the swara that you actually stop the raga with. In many cases, shajja or sa happens to be the graha and nyasa for a raga. There may be other cases where it is not, but for many ragas you can think sa as the graha swara. So, and then let's also define something called murchana. Murchana means actually going up one octave and coming back. So in case of Mohana, you sang, right? Sa ri ga pa da sa, sa da pa ga ri sa. This is the arohana avarohana of Mohana. And this is actually, more technically, shajja murchana of Mohana. Because you start it with shajja. You could also sing it something like, Re ga pa da sa ri, ri sa da pa ga ri. Still we are not deviating from the raga Mohana. It is the Rishabha Murchana of the same raga Mohana. So you could also have it starting from pa. Pa da sa ri ga pa, pa ga ri sa da pa. Right? So any raga or any scale can have the shajja murchana, rishabha murchana or whatever murchana that is permissible in that particular case. Right? Is this clear or are there any questions before we move ahead? Clear? Okay. Now, I defined what graha is. Graha is the starting note for a given raga or scale. Bheda is a Sanskrit word, it's also used in Kannada and many other Indian languages. Bheda means actually difference, in difference with. So, the word by word meaning of Graha Bheda means to change the starting note. Okay? So, there is also an equivalent term in Western music, it's called modal shift. So, mode actually refers to something like a raga and the scale which they are playing, and if you suddenly start playing at some other scale, some other key, so it's called a key shift or modal shift. So what happens is, if you're singing a alapana, a swarakalpana of a given raga, and then suddenly put your emphasis on certain other note and make a different murchana for the same raga, you can indeed bring out the feel of a different raga. And this is in total the essence of what Graha Bheda is. But why this happens? So we'll see. We will see how this happens. Just now I sang what? The scale of Mohana, right? Sari ga pa da sa. And remember, each raga is characterized by stress of different notes, right? Certain notes are stressed, certain notes are not stressed. Ri ga pa da sa ri. So I can make it sound like Mohana by stressing the right notes. But if I emphasize certain notes and de-emphasize certain other notes, it can definitely start feeling like another raga. Keenly listen. Sa re ga pa da sa sa da pa ga re sa re re ga ga pa pa da da sa sa re 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 sa da pa ga re What I did is, I actually placed stress on different notes rather than what I would do for Mohana, and it started sounding like another raga called Madhyamavati. So if you know Madhyamavati, it's born out of a different mela. It's a totally different raga altogether. So, is it possible only with Mohana, or do we get only Madhyamavati with Mohana? We can actually play certain examples and see what happens. I have actually recorded some of these things myself, so that you get to hear what happens. See, I'm still singing Mohana now. So now pay attention where I start the new murchana. Still it's sounding like Mohana. Who knows this raga? Hindola, right? So we got into Hindola right from Mohana. And now I am coming back to Mohana. So we started with Mohana, we did not change any notes. We didn't change any notes. But just by making stress on certain notes, we heard Hindola within Mohana. So what two ragas did we get from Mohana? We got Madhyamavati, we got Hindola. So let's see another example. Do you know a Gita in Analekara? Okay, let's see. So again I start here with Mohana. So still it is Mohana. Sa, 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 sa sara pa ma ri sa So you can fleetingly go into another raga and come back to whatever raga you started with. So we saw what some magic is happening, but yeah.
So there is no Maya now.
In Mohana, Mohana, right?
So
yeah.
How did you get to that?
Yeah. So that's what I'll come to.
Okay.
So you heard Ma because I started with a different note, and then actually given the intervals of the raga, if I am singing in akara, you will not hear the Ma, right? But you will get the feel of Shuddha Savari. I'll put some concert clips where this happens. I actually said it in swara so that it's more easier for us to understand what is happening. Okay. But we saw what is happening, but we yet don't know why this is happening, right? So what we will do now is understand the mathematics behind it to see how we got in this case Ma in a raga that did not have Ma before, right? So we all know there are seven swaras, right? Sa, Ri, Ga, Ma, Pa, Da, Ni. What about the next Sa? Aren't there eight swaras? Okay, yeah. Because it belongs to the next sthayi, right? So you have mandra sthayi, madhya sthayi, and tara sthayi. So when you are saying sarigama padani, it belongs to one sthayi, and the next set of sarigama padani goes to the next sthayi. So sa and pa don't have any variation. Any raga is the same thing, right? It's called the prakriti swara. While the swaras ri, ga, and da, ni have three varieties. Three varieties, right? Shuddha Rishabha, Chatushruti Rishabha, Shatshruti Rishabha, and Shuddha Gandhara, Sadharana Gandhara, and Antara Gandhara, and similarly for Da and Ni. But there is some kind of equality in there where the Chatushruti Rishabha in value or in tone is equivalent to the level where Shuddha Gandhara is. And similarly, the Shetshruti Rishabha, meaning the note that you call as Shetshruti Rishabha in Raga Se Nati, is the same as the note that you call Sadharana Gandhara in Ananda Bhairavi.
Yeah,
right?
I know about that.
Yeah. So, between these six variations in Ri and Ga, actually we have only four levels. Right? So, for simplicity, what we will do is, we will call these two as Rishabha. Okay? Ri1 and Ri2. And we will call this as Gavan and Gatu. Okay, don't have to confuse with our regular nomenclature where we will have Ri1, Ri2, Ri3, etc. Right? So this is this clear? So Ri, Ga, Da, Ni all have two variations, and Ma, as we all know, has only two variations anyway: Shuddha Madhyama and Prati Madhyama. So one octave has a total of 12 notes. Right? Can you all see this?
That is
pretty enough. Yeah. Right? So this is how one octave looks like. Mm-hmm. Sa, Ri1, Ri2, Ga1, Ga2, Ma1, Ma2, Pa, Da1, Da2, Ni1, Ni2, Sa. So, when we take a scale like Mohana, we can actually assign the notes where they belong to, right? We have Sa, and we have the Chatushruti Rishabha, and we have the Antara Gandhara, and we don't have any Madhyama, right? And then we have the Panchama, and we have the Chatushruti Rishabha, Chatushruti Daivata, and we don't have any Nishada, and then we have Sa. Right? So, there is a difference of 1 here, difference of 1, and difference of 2, difference of 1, and difference of 2. Right? So, let's see what happens when we shift this one to get a different Murchana. So, I'll write it a little smaller so that you can all see this. Okay. So, I had to go to the next style so that when we go to rig up the sari, we will know what is happening, right? So, first I will just circle the notes that belong to Mohan. Right, this completes one style. It's the next higher ri, higher ga. Right, this is Mohan.
Chukka hakuli higher ri.
So now, let's see the Rishabha Murchana. Rishabha Murchana of Mohan, right? So we will start from here. When you say Rishabha Murchana, means okay, you are assuming that your new sa is at the place of ri. Okay, so let's just write down.
Your starting point has changed.
The starting point has changed from sa to ri. So if I had the new sa here, what will happen? This will be the E1, this will be the E2, this will be Ga1, this will be Ga2, Ma1, Ma2, Pa, Da1, Da2, Ni1, Ni2, Sa, V1, V2. Remember, I did not change the position of notes that I was singing. So I still was singing here. Right? So if you look at this, Sa, Ri, Ma, Pa, Ni, Sa. Sa, Chatushruti Rishabha, Shuddha Madhyama, Panchama, then Kaishiki Nishadha and Sa. And which is actually Madhyamavati.
Did you follow what he did just now?
Mm-hmm. So this is the actual answer why a raga like Shuddha Saviri can come from Mohana. So Mohana happens to be one of the few ragas that can give another raga when you do a shift. Okay, if you shift further to Ga, right? Let's see what happens. If this is my new sa, this is V1, V2, Ga1, Ga2, Ma1, Ma2, Pa, Da1, Ga2, Ni1, Ni2, Sa. Right? So I will still sing at the same places.
No, you missed something there.
No?
Re, you should have chosen Re 2.
Yeah.
No.
Our position still remains.
Okay, sorry, you're doing it differently.
Yeah. So, right? So now this was the Gandhara Murchana, right? So, for originally, this was Mohana. Now I am starting with Gandhara and going up to the Talasthani Gandhara. Right? And then I reassign the notes. What will happen? This is Shedja. And this becomes Sadharana Gandhara. This becomes Shuddha Madhyama. This becomes Shuddha Daivata. Kaishiki Nishadha. And Shedja. Which I sang just now, right? What was that raga? Hindola, right? That was Hindola. So, Mohana on, if you start from Ri, it gives Madhyamavati. If you start from Ga, it can give you Hindola. If you start from Pa, it will give Shuddha Saveri. If you start from Da, it will give another raga called Shuddha Danyasi. So all the notes in Raga Mohana can give you another raga on a Murchana. So it's called a Sarvaswara Murchana Karaka Raga. And there is another magic here. If Raga A gives Raga B, when you do a modal shift, when you do a Graha Bheda, then Raga B gives Raga A, when you do it on some other note. It's very easy to explain. We had Mohana. Mohana gave Madhyamavati. Madhyamavati gave, and Mohana also gave Hindola. But what if you had started with the Madhyamavati? If you started with Madhyamavati, and started with the Re-Murchana of Madhyamavati, you got Hindola. And instead, if you started with the Ni Murchana, right? Starting from the Nishada for Madhyamavati, see if this was Sa, this would be Ni2, and this would be Ni1, right? If you started with the Ni1, the Nishada Murchana of Madhyamavati, you would indeed get Mohana. So, if a Raga A gives Raga B, Raga B will give Raga A. Okay? Is this point clear? Understood? Okay. So, now we saw a pentatonic scale, or an audio raga. But you don't have to actually have an audio raga only to make this model shape. It can be any sort of raga. You can get a sampurna raga from a sampurna raga.
Good.
You can also get a pentatonic scale from a sampurna raga by appropriately leaving or dropping certain notes. But when you drop such notes, you have to actually make sure you are not changing the raga bhava of the original raga to start with. Because if I am singing some raga, if I am singing Shankaravarna, and then suddenly start dropping, you know, ma and ni, it might start sounding like Mohan, or it might start sounding more like Bilahari instead of Mohan. So you will have to actually think about what notes can be dropped without affecting the original bhava of the particular raga. So now, at the beginning we saw one example, right? That was Balamurli Krishna singing Mohana Kalyani to Todi, right? So we'll see what happened. It's very similar to what we did here. Instead of writing here, I'll just show you on the slide. So if I am showing one particular octave in one color, so all the red is the Madhyasthayi, this is the Talasthayi, this is the Mandrasthayi. So Kalyani is what? Kalyani sa, Ri tu, Chatushruti Rishabha, Antara Gandhara, Prati Madhyama, Panchama, Chatushruti Daivata, Kakali Nishyada, and Shetra. And if we did, instead of starting from sa, if we did a Nishada Murchana, that is starting from ni. So ni sa ri ga ma pa da ni, and reassign the swaras. What will happen? I basically shifted this 1 to 12 from sa to ni. So what we got was sa ri one, ga one, ma one, pa da one, ni one, and sa, which is tod, right? So that is how we got one melakarta raga from another melakarta raga. And I was telling you that, and we don't have to do this only from seven notes to seven notes. We can also do from 7 notes to 6 notes or 5 notes. Now I will play a clip. Listen keenly, and I'm sure all the students here know both the ragas, so it should be easy for you. Okay, you just listen keenly and tell me what is happening. Okay, this is from a concert, so recording may not be all that good, but so get what raga this is. We already saw this at the beginning. So it's the same raga. Come on, quick.
Kalyani?
Yeah. Okay, now listen. Now listen where the magic happens. What is happening?
What raga is?
What is it sounding like? So this is another raga you sang today.
Yeah.
Mohana, right?
From Kalyani, he was able to do Mohana. He comes back to his sa. He has moved his sa right to the position of re. So the violinist at that time just holds that note steady, the re, and he uses that as his bass sa. The vocalist will use that as the bass sa, and from there he has moved all the notes like you just saw. The Mohana sa moved to the position of re, and then he built his notes from there and produced Mohana from Kalyani.
So what he was doing, Jayanti just now explained what was happening, right? So the accompanist might just give the new sa, but he might just keep playing the re in this case.
So the re has become the new sa.
So to explain that, actually I think I have a small clip to show why how we got that.
But the trick is they have to come back to the original sa eventually. If they don't, that means they will start singing a new raga. That is not permitted.
Yeah. Okay, if I don't find, that's fine. Sa 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 ri ga ma pa da ni sa. That is the original scale, right? Sa ri ga ma pa da ni sa. Ri ri sa ni ra pa ma ga ri. But in Kalyani, you can actually skip pa and sa. Okay, it actually adds more color. Re, re, ga, ma, da, ni, re, re, ni, da, ma, ga, re. It's very, very popular sanchara. Re, ga, ma, da, ni, re, ni, da, ma, ga, re, ga, ma, da, ma, ga, re. I'm not sounding like mono at this point, but the moment I start making my re very flat. Re, re, ga, ma, da, ni, re, 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 ni, da, ma, ga, re. Sa da pa ga re sa. By actually giving the right emphasis, okay, right gamakas for the notes, which may not be 100% Kalyani at that point of time, you can bring out the raga such as Mohana. Right? Did you get this point? Okay. So when in it, yeah.
Wait, so does this all happen through handling the note?
It happens through handling the note. Basically, how they sing it. This is what you have to watch out for in a concert. So you're this is something particularly you have to pay attention, because this will not last more than a minute. Okay, if the artist is singing for 15 minutes one raga, right? This will not last more than 1 minute. Okay, most likely what will happen is it will be over before you know what happened. And the only indication that you might know is, okay, people clapping. So people who follow it will clap. Otherwise, you might be actually wondering what happened. So the next time, if you are paying attention, you will immediately catch. And if you did not catch it during when the vocalist did, most likely the violinist will repeat it. Okay? So that is a good indication that, okay, if you miss something, okay, pay attention to the violinist. Now you will see. It's the same concert. So where the violinist is repeating what the vocalist did.
Still in Kalyani. He's holding on re.
It's still Kalyani.
Transforming. Yeah.
Can hear Mohana so clearly here.
He did it very well actually. Yeah. Instrumental easy.
Yeah, and this is much easier done on an instrument. Okay? So it's more challenging to it in vocal. So you can see Mohana in its in a full beauty.
He went back to sa. You heard the sa?
And you hear the clap, right? So now if you remember any episode like this, probably this is what had happened in this answer. Okay? So...
But that's not the only time people clap.
No.
Hopefully.
It's also one of the times. Okay. And probably this clap will be smaller than the other.
Yeah, it's not a major clap.
It's not such a major clap because it's done very subtly.
And I think we'll have the audience recognize it.
We can't really tell where it happened. It might happen in between. Normally it will happen during the Alapne.
Okay.
It might also happen in the Kalpana Swara. Okay. And I'll show you a composition where it is done. The whole composition can be done like this, which is very rare. Yeah.
This is mostly happen in Carnatic or Hindustani music?
This can happen in, it's more in Carnatic Sangeeta, but it can also happen in Hindustani. And if people are interested, I can send different links I have, where you can watch it on video or whatever it is. So, the more you listen, the more you can start appreciating it. So, now,
I have a question.
Yeah.
So then if someone was singing Mohan in Shruti for with the Shruti on F sharp, mm-hmm. and they change to the next raga, would that be on G sharp?
Yeah, it's like change singing in G sharp, but the thing, the point is they are not changing the Shruti. Mm-hmm. Okay? So that is why you start, you know, feeling it's a different raga. So they still are singing in F sharp, as though the placement of Sa is like they are in G sharp or, you know, one lower, right? Yeah.
If you change the Shruti, would you still hear it because you're going to a different raga?
That's right. They are not actually changing the Shruti. Okay, yeah. They won't change the Shruti. But, you know, in a concert, the violinist might hold the Re or Da, wherever it is, so that people also can, okay, guess what is happening. Okay, you might start latching into a different Shruti, right? So I will actually now play a clip. It's very, at this moment, it's the right moment. I'll play a short clip. Listen to it and tell me what raga it looks like, okay?
The challenge for the musician is because he's hearing he or she is still hearing the tamburi shruti in the background. It's hard to shut your ear off to that and then switch.
Right, because you're not changing the shruti.
You're not allowed, in our music concert, you're never allowed to change the shruti. Once you start on a shruti, you have to finish the concert.
You just don't touch the shruti at all,
you cannot
right?
move it in between. You can do a madhyama shruti in between for songs, but you can't change to G sharp. Oh, the song is too low for me, let me just change. You can't do that.
You can't do that. Now listen to this. Now, any of you, do you recognize what raga this is? This is not a quiz, by the way. Okay, it's a very short clip. You don't have to be recognizing the raga, but if you know, if you think it sounds like something, just tell me. Or, you know, if you don't, that's fine too. Okay, that's fine. So this is supposed to be, I mean, as per, if you look at the sleeves of the cassette, it says it's the Tilana in Tilang. Okay? Tilang has, it's a Sagama Panisa Sani Pamagasa. As has the scale Sagama Panisa Sani Pamagasa. But most of the time when I listen to this, it doesn't sound to me like Sagama Panisa Sani Pamagasa, but instead it sounds to me like Sagama Danisa Sani Damagasa. So what is happening? Okay? I'll show why this might sound like a different note. Just now, Jayanti was telling about Madhyama Shruti, right? Some ragas have a very strong Madhyama. If the raga has a very strong Madhyama, and particularly if it happens, if you walk in between something is being sung, and you don't know where they have started, and then you latch on to the Madhyama Shruti of that song instead of the sa. So, vocalist may be singing actually Hindora, but you walked in between and your mind actually hooked on to the Madhyama instead of the Shajja, and you start, you think you are actually listening to Shuddha Danyasi. And then at the end of the Alapane, he might start singing Samajavagamana. So then you wonder what happened. This is probably what would happen in that case. It happens in ragas where they don't have very pronounced gamakas. So that is where it can happen much easily. So ragas like Hindola and Shuddha Danyasi can be sung to a very good extent without giving extra gamakas. Unlike say ragas like Todi or Shankarabharna, it's very hard to sing with plain notes. But Shuddha Danyasi and Hindola, you can still make a decent alapane even with singing flat notes. So
she has a question.
Yeah.
Can the shift also happen in the middle of the song, or does it mostly happen?
Yeah, it normally happens in the middle of the song. So normally happens in the middle of the alapana.
Because you have to establish your first raga very well, correct? You suddenly start doing this. Whether you don't know, are you singing Mohana or singing Kalyani, you get confused.
So they have to be singing one particular raga before shifting to the other. So in this particular example...
She has another question.
Yeah, good.
So if the scale has a D3, then would those alignment change to Sa, Re1, Re2, Re3?
Yeah, if in the original raga it was Re3, right? So you would actually put it here instead of, I mean, you are only saying it's E3, right? It's at the same level of Ga 1, right? The Sadharana in this example. So, nothing will change. In one raga you may be saying Sari, in the other raga you may be saying Saga.
The same position.
The equation won't change. And depending on the locations, all ragas cannot yield valid ragas when you make a modal shift.
If you like write it down with Riti, would you go like Sari when I do Riti and go to Ga 2?
Yeah, if it was a raga with 3-3, so you might, it has to be something like this. Sari Ga. So that would be your original raga. Okay, so for that, if this was a note, say Da 1, or it was Da 2, say for example, Da 2. Ni 1, Ni 2, Sa. You can have a valid Murchana with this one as Da. Sa Ri Ga would become Da Ni Sa. Right? So, in certain cases, if you get certain notes like Ma 1 and Ma 2, you know, adjacent to each other, which normally does not happen in our music, so that can give an invalid raga. Okay, tell me.
Where would you put Ni 3?
Ni 3 actually, see, I told you, right? It was Da 1, Da 2, Da 3. It's the same thing as Ni 1, Ni 2, Ni 3. I mean, what we normally call as Ni 3. So here in this representation, I'm just calling Ni as Ni 1, Ni 2, Da as Da 1, Da 2. Okay?
This is it. Ni 2, Ni 3.
Yeah.
Again, that's an overlapping note.
It's an overlapping note, right? Yeah.
So if you go from Kalyani to Yaman Kalyani, are you performing Graha?
No. Kalyani to Yaman Kalyani, they're very similar ragas actually. I mean, Kalyani is called Yaman in Hindustani. Mm-hmm. And there is a raga called Yaman Kalyani which has both Madhyamas. So, and a raga similar to that we have in Karnataka Sangeeta which we call Yaman Kalyani. Okay? So, the difference is in Hindustani music they pay much attention to the Graha Swaras. So in Kalyani they never sing, in Yaman they never sing Sa Re Ga Ma, never. It is all the Ni Re Ga Ma, okay? Ni Re Ga Ma Da Ni Sa, Ni Da Ma Ga Re Sa, Ni Da Pa Ma Ga Re Sa. That is how they would sing Yaman. But we can sing Sa Re Ga Ma Ba Da Ni Sa, Sa Ni Da Pa Ma Ga Re Sa. We can sing Ni Re Ga Ma Ga Re, that is fine. But not necessarily always, but in Hindustani they will never take a Sarigama in Yaman. It's always Nirigama. Okay?
How is this different from playing Raga Malike?
Yeah, so when you are playing Raga Malike, so it'll be Sarigama Pada Ni Sa Ni Da Pa Ma Ga Ri Sa, Sarigapa Da Sa Sa Da Pa Ga Ri Sa, Sagama Da Ni Sa Sa Ni Da Ma Ga Sa. So you play the Shajja for all ragas at the same pitch. At your pitch. But here you have mentally shifted your pitch, although nothing has changed, and of the pitch outside, all other instruments, nothing has changed.
She has a question.
Wait, yeah. So then in a Raga Malika, it's basically disjointed, right? And then when you can think it like,
yeah, they are disjointed, you just put them together just next to each other, like putting different flowers, different color flowers next to each other. So this is like extending the same thing over a different range. I think we are running out of time, right? Yeah. So, I told that, you know, there are compositions, entire compositions based on Graha Bheda. There is a Varna, which is in the Mohana, Shuddha Saveri, Shuddha Danyasi, which uses Graha Bheda. There is also one composition by Dr. Nagavalli Nagaraj, who has its five charanas are in these five ragas, which is sung as a Graha Bheda, not as a Raga Malike. And finally, there is also a Pallavi recording by Dr. Balmurli Krishna, where he does a Natabhairavi Pallavi, and then does Graha Bheda to get Shankarabharna, Todi, Kalyani, Karalapriya. Okay, it's a wonderful recording, it's a must listen. And he also has a composition called a Thaya Malika Tillana. Thaya was an ancient concept. We don't have such compositions now. He, I think, has tried to bring back whatever was there earlier, where parts of it is not 100% Graha Bheda. It will be, there will be a shift, a very subtle shift, go back to get a feeling of Graha Bheda, but not 100%. So that is the Thaya. I will end with that composition. I will just play a clip from that. So this has all possibilities. He starts with Raga Kalyani. He goes to Shankaravarna. He goes to Hindola. He goes to Mohana. He goes to Darbari Kannada. All possible combinations are there. So just listen to that. It's a majestic composition. Very, very difficult to sing, except for people like Balamurli Krishna. It's very hard to attempt. So this one is starting in Kalyani. So all along, facing in Kalyani, there's no change. So this is necessary to establish the identity of the first raga. So otherwise you don't have an anchor to it. So he does the first one here. So he also sings the note, so you will see. So that is like in Shankaravarna. And specifically in this composition, he is never leaving Kalyani. He is always singing Kalyani. It's not like he has gone to the other raga at all. Unlike in the other cases where briefly they were actually stressing on the gamakas of Mohana raga or whatever new raga they got. Here he is, all the time he is in Kalyani, but the feel is totally going to another raga. So now he gets to Mohana.
Mohana doesn't have me, but then the
Chaya
is, you're hearing the feeling of Mohana in the background.
Because he sings both, you see, he's not actually changing the notes how they should be sung in Kalyani. He's not at all changing that. So, but he sings Sada Pagari to let you know that, okay, it's the Chaya.
It's hard to do it.
So he'll just hold it, whatever. da mar da re 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 Run for some of the 2 minutes, okay. So he came back again. He's skipping Ri in Kalyani. He's singing Madasa to make it like Risada. Risadani, which is a very characteristic phrase in Darbari Kannada.
Murali is
a
signature.
Balmurali
Krishna's signature.
It's
his own composition.
So this is called the Rachana Mudra. So it says it's a Raga Thaya Malika. So all compositions won't have it. Sometimes they have the Raga Mudra telling the name of the Raga. But this doesn't have. But it tells that what type of composition it is. It says it is a Raga Thaya Malika. Then I come to the end of this presentation. Thanks for listening, and I hope you got something out of it. Next time when you go to a concert, keep watching for these things. You don't have to worry that if you don't get it the first time. Okay? So you understand these things better and better as you listen to more and more music. Now there is a lot of concerts available on the site, which are Sangeeta Priya.
Sangeetapriya.org.
So
all the children have to this. 1 minute, 1 minute. 1 second, please. I just, yeah, you can ask your questions.